and you can see our full portfolio of events. We've been talking a lot today about and seeing a lot of car marketing and advertising that weaves its way into people's lifestyles and values. But there is still a place for romance in the romance of driving and the romance of cars. And we're pleased to have with us a brand that really knows that and knows how to sell it. Alfa Romeo is a brand of childhood with a dilemma of associations. We're going to catch up on the brand now, but let's take a look at an ad that deservedly went fully viral online that really demonstrates the ways in which Alfa Romeo really understands the romance of driving and has no problem communicating that to its audience. Let's roll it.
I never dreamed that I meet somebody like you, and I never dreamed that I'd lose somebody like you.
Let me invite to the stage one of the minds behind that ad, Bob Broderdorfer, is the director of Alfa Romeo North America. Bob knows romantic Italian brands. He has worked previously at Maserati and at Fiat. Please welcome Bob.
Thanks, everybody.
So, as I said, Bob, I remember Alfa from my childhood and associations with a lot of popular culture and a lot of romance as a premium brand. Tell us a little, why don't we define where Alfa is now in recent years and how it's evolved as it's coming into the back into the U.S. market.
Yeah, so if you're new to Alfa Romeo, so the brand actually, it's a 100-year-old brand. And it's something that's been around the globe for some time. However, after really a 25-year absence in the United States over the last 4 years, we've had a unique opportunity of bringing back really one of the most historic brands, really from an aspirational standpoint. And the brand today, it really, and I think the creative also showcases just sort of, you use the word romance. There's a sex appeal to having an Italian brand like this, and cars that truly, truly perform on the track and the street. They're throughout, you know, best power to class weight ratios, lightweight architectures, but stunning style and precision that I think customers kind of admire and often go after.
And tell us a little bit about that ad and those two models, because they're part of the push too, and how that, you know, how that ad evolves, but also why and how you chose to use two different models in an ad.
Yeah. So so for us, obviously. The American buyer is still learning what is Alfa Romeo and trying to drive our awareness up. Leveraging those two vehicles, they're based off the same architecture, both lightweight, but obviously our first chance to bring a UV to the marketplace. So we wanted to showcase not only can our car, the Giulia, as you would expect, really perform dynamically, but our UV can as well. So having really the two stars of the brand, the two volume nameplates of our brand, both new to the marketplace, both, you know, needing awareness gains, that ad really showcased not only sort of the history of Alfa and just sort of what the perception and the feel of the brand should be, those tangible, quantifiable elements, but as well as the driving dynamics of the cars. And what's crazy about that ad is their ability, I mean, that was actually, it's no CG, that was two professional drivers on a track. Moving two cars that close between one another really drove really some incredible piece of content and creative.
And with the song association, with the brands, with the styling, who are you targeting as you're coming into the market?
Oh, so Alfa is very strategically positioned as a premium brand. We want it to be sold as premium with that sort of Italian luxury heritage, but also a volume brand. So it's strategically positioned against our other German counterparts. It's clearly going after something that they cookie cutter do over and over again. And I think we have a very unique approach and style to what Alfa Romeo is all about.
So you came into the market, and especially with a Super Bowl ad. So tell us about the Super Bowl ad.
Well, look, Super Bowl, obviously. I mean, you're going to find very few venues on the planet that you're going to be able to drive that many eyeballs to something. So I think in almost a slightly arrogant fashion, in order to do the very first thing that you're going to do with this brand is go right after the Super Bowl and tell everyone that we're here. But also from a strategic standpoint, our ability to fill the funnel right away, get a lot of visits to the website, see massive incrementality from a Super Bowl spot, also gave us the opportunity to have people inside the funnel that we can now target, recommunicate to, leverage some of that data, and see really who is aspirationally going after Alfa Romeo.
So what kind of results did you see off of that?
Oh, I skyrocketed tenfold. I don't know, Nate can give you some crazy statistic.
Now, we're in a digital age, though, and there had to be bean counters involved who were saying, oh, the waste of a Super Bowl ad. All the people who you're never going to get to buy an Alfa who are seeing that ad.
Oh, strangely enough, I mean, you're talking to the guys at FCA that I think for years have kind of made a staple of what the Super Bowl could be and how you can artistically tell a story, not only of a brand evolving, but as a company that came out of bankruptcy all the way to what FCA is today. When you're on the Super Bowl, it clearly states to everybody in the industry, you're strong, you're proud, you have a message, you have something to say, as well as strategically driving traffic. So I don't think FCA looks at it as a bean counter point of view. Mm-hmm. And clearly on Alfa, I mean, people need to be made aware that Alfa exists. Mm-hmm. And as you guys probably know better than anybody, I mean, driving awareness takes time. Takes a detailed, focused plan to continue to do it the right way.
Okay, so you needed to make a brand statement, and that was part of the Super Bowl ad. Let's talk. And you mentioned that it had a history. It had a history that it had to come out of and sort of work out of. What? How did the voice evolve? How has the voice of Alfa evolved through this?
Well, the voice, particularly, if you think about from, so you're really starting from scratch with an old school history back 60s and 70s, last time it was here. From a voice standpoint, at first, we just wanted the phrase, the word, the essence of what Alfa Romeo is supposed to be into the marketplace. But once you evolve from, okay, now we've established Alfa's out there, we want to leverage data to be very, very finite in who's starting to engage with the brand. Mm-hmm. And then where we can go with that. So the voice has transitioned from all the way to, hey, Alfa exists, it's back in the United States, all the way to here are the key purchase reasons based on a data standpoint. Not only that, where are these people actually located? 60% of all of our volume comes from New York, Miami, and LA. You can add up pretty much the other 10% of the volume is Houston, Dallas area, and Chicago. So it allows us to get hyper-focused and deliver addressable advertising, addressable media. We can get very targeted with digital and deliver a particular kind of the actual type of person that we're getting. You know, we know we skew over male. The top purchase reason is fun to drive. The second reason is style. So any of our messaging, our communication, any of our really dynamic creative that we have is going to revolve around those types of elements. Okay, here's the path of least resistance, but one thing that we're not getting is the female buyer. And part of the launch with Stelvio was to showcase not only do you have a great empowering vehicle, but you've also got the storage functionality that might an everyday household might want. So I think it does really two things for you. It allows you to find, here's the path of least resistance of who we're getting today, and then here's what I'm not getting. Mm-hmm. So if we evolve the strategy, the creative, you can take a little bit different approach to drive that home.
Now, we didn't talk about the social virality of that piece that we just showed. Will you tell a little bit about the social impact and how the ways in which you saw it distributed online?
Oh yeah, there's no, look, I think we got a bit of a history, particularly with the creative team that we have. I mean, you look at Olivier Francois and his team, it starts with him. We've got three really unique partners with Marissa Hunter, Susan Thompson, Mal, Ellen, and each of them own a different part of it, and working with the brand team, from a viral standpoint, if you take the marketing creative that those guys deliver, as well as a strategic viral message, and you're not afraid to be outside the box, cut through the clutter, find something very unique about your ad, people certainly will drive to it, they'll want to post it, they'll retweet it. That's all part of what we try to do strategically. And anybody in here can't take a massive budget and buy a whole bunch of meat and put my ad all over the place. Mm-hmm. But the ability to get a sort of, I'll call it an unfair share of attention through viral, and making sure that message is out in the marketplace, that's what makes the difference when we talk about bean counters and getting a higher return on your investment.
Were you learning anything about the audience as you were doing that and getting that feedback, seeing the virality, seeing who was sharing in the social media? Were you getting a deep, more targeted or more precise understanding of who this really was resonating with that maybe surprised you?
I think the part that surprises me is just, even though people might not know it, the household income, the type of demographic, the type of person that's migrating to Alfa Romeo and their level of expectation from an experience standpoint, it happened faster than I thought. There was an allure to it. There's something about being a Italian brand that is not something that you see every day on the road. There's a lot of people that want something different. They want a particular cachet that they would see, particularly with their purchase. And I think that we've picked that up very, very quickly. And a lot of the viral that you talked about, positioning in the marketplace, made a huge difference in that standpoint.
And now, talking about targeting and maybe finding surprising audiences, you also did a partnership that fascinates me with, it's called Unity Technologies, which is a company, for those of you not familiar with, Unity probably drives a lot of the first-person video games that a lot of you play. It's probably driven by Unity Technologies' 3D platform. And you partnered with them to do a special execution. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what that execution was, and particularly why you partnered with them and what you got out of it?
Yes, them particularly. Look, they're capable of delivering some pretty cool video games, some exciting stuff. What I thought the allure really was when we talked about this campaign is how can we take an ad, all right, and then make it fully 360 encompassing and drive incremental engagement and get them down to our website. So the video game usage was, not only did it take the message that you saw inside the creative, but then it drove an engagement level through the video game and then to our website. We've had 85,000 people have already played the game in just about 2 weeks, and all of them we continue to migrate to our website. The website traffic is up substantially because of it, and I think it also increases the level of engagement, providing what I'll call sort of a virtual test drive. I mean, it's one thing for me to showcase to you, oh yeah, hey, these cars are amazing, here's the footage, et cetera. But then when you can also give yourself some sort of virtual experience on there, driving the video, playing the video game, and then driving you right to the site, all encompassed on our website, it's a pretty cool combination. And ultimately, the way I judge the scorecard is, look, if I gave my marketing team, all right, here's X millions of dollars, et cetera, well, what can you go get for me? But if I could take that same budget, get this much more from an online perspective, and then increase the engagement at the time on my site, again, then you start to get a better return.
How did you distribute it? How are people finding that?
Yeah. Oh, actually, so we've leveraged social media, YouTube. You can find it through the game. We also had a press release that we put out there. I think our combination of leveraging a press release, letting people know that it's out there, tying it to the creative, and then finding it across our social platforms makes a world of difference of quickly communicating that something like that exists.
So you're coming back into the U.S. market as a premium brand. So tell us a little bit about how you're doing that targeting and finding those consumers.
Yeah, so we talked a little bit about the regional variations, right. But essentially for us, you got all of your digital data through your website, and we got third-party surveys. Auto shows, a whole bunch of other areas where we can start to garner and capture through surveys, whichever dynamic. But really the key to us is, okay, what do all, grab all this data, what does it see? Where do you want to go? Where is the really, and we talked about the path of least resistance. How do you capitalize on that type of traffic? Right, because it's one thing, great if I drive all this traffic, but if I'm not actually converting into a sale at the showroom, then I'm not doing what I need to do. So I think between us and the dealers, we found a pretty compelling relationship to deliver on that.
Well, that brings us to that landing page, because I know that you guys made a significant investment in revamping your website experience.
Yeah,
tell us what, so sort of walk us through how you reconceptualized what the website should be to satisfy all those needs that you just outlined.
Yeah, the website in particular was really a massive undertaking. And the team that went through the exercise, so to give you guys a little bit of understanding, it's most websites, most OEMs, I think they have really a traditional interface, a traditional build and price. Build and price is easily one of the biggest traffic driving resources for us. So we decided to completely gut it, start over with a mobile first application. And the reason what drove that is we know that 65% of our traffic today comes from mobile devices. So if you're going to have people on their phones looking inside into your brand, it's going to be imperative that the experience on your iPhone, on your Android, whatever it might be, delivers a premium type of experience. So I encourage you, go onto our website, take a look at it on your phones and compare it to some other manufacturers. Starting with a mobile-first application can really change the entire dynamic of what the experience is like for the customer. And we all know in this day and age, the speed by which you can deliver your information will only help your conversion and drive an extra lead.
Now, how is that connecting down the tiers towards the local level and local dealerships?
Almost immediately, we saw a 10-point lift in conversion, which if you take the mathematically a 10-point lift in conversion, it pays for itself infinitely. So while there was a lot of blood, sweat, and tears went into changing it, the benefits are overwhelming.
Were you making sure, in working at the more local level, you were making sure that that experience was carried through to the end?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, so, I think you'll see that on our site.
Okay. So, beyond digital and TV, you guys are also still well invested into experiential marketing. Tell us a little bit about your presence and your sponsorship presence, especially with in various events, and how that fits into the mix then.
Yeah, so let's, when it comes to experiential, obviously, look, anytime we can showcase what a car is capable of doing at an event for our consumers, clearly that's a place you want to go with experiential marketing. But for a brand like Alfa Romeo that's very performance-oriented, experiential events allow us not only to showcase what these cars are capable of doing, but to get test drives, drive incremental sales. But one of the pieces that I think is often overlooked is the ability to capture content. All of us today are looking for content. You're looking for creative ways to articulate a story. And we can take experiential events, showcase the content of people doing this, so that if you're not capable of coming to one of our events, you can see other people, real world, having an incredible and amazing experience inside of an Alfa Romeo that drives home that type of experience. And then I will call more your cookie cutter, your Concours d'Elegance, some of these other events. I mean, if premium buyers are in that marketplace, we know that. Then we are expected to be there, and that's a place you'll continuously see us. That's the kind of thing where an Alfa Romeo buyer should be, and if you truly are gonna deliver a premium product, you need to be able to hold your own at those events.
Now, that's an interesting point that I hear more and more brands make across a lot of categories, is thinking of events within a new social economy, that events now in many ways replace or are the new kind of TV shoot. Where you're creating content that can then become media online.
Yeah, there's no question. Anytime you can lever expenses to get more content and actually even shoot a creative, put it in your ad, showcase it on your website, showcase it on even social channels, all of that stuff matters to continue to drive home the story. Because especially in a brand like Alfa Romeo, if you're not familiar and you start to follow it, the more and more touch points that we can have with you will only help the conversions that much further.
How about auto shows?
So
what role does an auto show play in all of this? With such a cacophony of cars up there.
Yeah, you know, it's I've had interviews all day today, and I think people have asked me over and over again, what do I think of auto shows? For us in particular, while whatever the attendance numbers may be, when you're launching a brand new brand like Alfa, where else am I going to find a venue where I can sit down with not only our consumers, but I can also sit down with the media, agencies, et cetera, and drive home the story that we're telling. I mean, the ability to sit down with journalists or even agency partners and explain, hey, here's where we're at. Here's where the story, here's where we're progressing, and here's kind of what we need, as well as an opportunity to actually sell cars and leverage the entire story through PR. I don't think you're going to find a better culmination of all of those things in one-stop shop, not to mention in New York, of all places. And if you can succeed here with a premium brand, what better place to do it in New York?
Are there other venues where you can create press buzz beyond auto shows, where you're finding where you can really engage the press and create media buzz?
Yeah, there's no question. Look, later today, we're going to showcase two completely exclusive, brand new production models over in our display, and the amount of attention that we'll receive from the media and our partners, et cetera, to get people excited about the brand, you'll rarely find an opportunity to be able to tell that story and slow down and really articulate it. It's so much more impactful than sending out a press release and just copy-paste, send it out. I'd much rather be able to articulate the story and why these things are special.
How have all of these media channels changed your relationship to the press itself? In terms of the ways in which you relate to journalists, and even the ways you define journalists in a broader world of blogging and social influencers.
Yeah, so look, I think in the automotive world, I think it's super easy to follow the traditional, all right, here's all the core books that we go to, the buff picks, and don't get me wrong, they all matter. They absolutely matter because it legitimizes what you're doing. But dismissing all of the social implications and the opportunities that you'd see through that is certainly something that needs to be paid attention to. And when you do these types of reveals and these types of conversations, I think it's something you can gravitate to quickly to drive home those messages over those touch points. As far as PR is concerned, I mean, I think you'll find very few teams in the auto industry where I've got Nate Bulow and Barrett. I mean, these guys are sitting right here together. They sit next to each other all day on the floor. I couldn't be more passionate about the ability to not only leverage the marketing budget, but the PR budget as well, and systematically place those touch points to drive traffic. We can prove that we can drive traffic to our website just through PR statements alone. So leveraging those two together, and PR in most cases, look, it's just effort, right? Coming out here, talking to you guys, revealing a car later on today at 3:30, all that stuff's just effort. And it really can get a massive bang for the buck to surround what's always a very difficult revenue and cost conversation when it comes to advertising.
Okay, let me end this, and please, I want to leave time for questions, so think of some questions. I want to bring this full circle back to TV then. So we've talked about all these other things after the Super Bowl ad and all of the other pieces of plan. So going forward, where does TV play a place in this? How much TV advertising do you do over the long term after the Super Bowl ad?
Oh, at what after kind? A Super Bowl?
Yeah, and you know, moving forward, what place does TV play for you?
So I think it's really a twofold type of strategy. I think, like, if you look at what we did last month, we were very heavy on March Madness. You've got a combination of eyeballs. We're going to hit a lot of people in a hurry, not necessarily driven to be super targeted. Mm-hmm. Whereas me personally, I love seeing the combination of not only giant awareness campaigns around March Madness, but then following it with very targeted addressable TV. On top of that, we usually spend... hold me, you say half Nate, half TV, half broadcast, the other half's digital. Mm-hmm. It's typically the way the spend breaks out. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you got your portions experiential and social, but essentially that's the way our budgets, I like half of it being super targeted. I'll call another half of the half addressable TV and targeted, and the rest driven.
Is addressable TV in the TV bucket or the digital bucket?
Sorry, addressable TV.
Yeah.
We keep it in our broadcast budget.
Okay,
but I'm usually
dividing TV between big broadcast, big events, and also those addressable.
Absolutely, yeah. We see that in there, and obviously it allows me to target. I can get very, very strategic with household income, certain mm-hmm. type of buyer. We can follow you with retargeting. The addressable TV is super advantageous, particularly if I want to target Miami. So mm-hmm. if I want to target somebody, it's 160,000 household income that lives in Miami around the dealerships. The other key component why I like addressable so much, if you look at our network, look, I'm still building the network. I've only got 165 stores. So if I spend a whole bunch of time driving traffic across the country, but I've got no store there, I just wasted my time. Right. And unique platforms like addressable allow me to do that. Very, very targeted.
Yeah, geo is especially, for addressable, geo is really one of those key strengths. We have some questions from the audience for Alpha. Over here, I think. Can we get a microphone over?
Yeah, I can yell it. Hi, Denise Blasevic, the S3 Agency. I know we're talking about a lot of the sexier art forms of marketing, but what role does email play for you?
Actually, email, it's simple and clean. If you want to get down to a tier two, tier three message with a simple email blast about an incentive change or any of the pricing opportunities we got in the marketplace, you get a right database and the right people that you're obviously monitoring. You don't want to waste your money. But very clearly, I mean, you can target email. We get a return off of it. If you get, depending on your owner base, I mean, you can get like a 1-2% return off of very, I'd say, act now type message in the marketplace. Like, we make a $500 move or a $1,000 move, particularly with an e-lead. I like to leverage that with an e-lead where somebody says, hey, we came in, they didn't buy it, we couldn't convert them. Hit them with another $750 offer after that. We actually see a lot of e-backs and get people back into the showroom off of a tactic like that. So email certainly has its place. Clean, simple, one quick, fast communication. I think you can get you can definitely drive traffic and sales off of it.
Another one?
Yep. Hi, Nathan Winston from Outfront. Just wanted to see if you could expound on your last comment a second ago of how you like to have kind of big tentpole, big awareness plays matched with the addressable and the targeting. It makes sense on the face, but then you made a comment of, you know, if you wouldn't target specifically, then you've got a lot of waste if it's not around stores. So how do you view the pairing specifically of doing those big kind of tentpole franchises or being around those big moments like March Madness, et cetera, with the addressable? Why do you find that works for you?
Well, so it might be more really our particular situation, but if you look at our funnel metrics and visits as well as conversions through the middle of the funnel, the biggest battle that we have is, one, I've only got a 54 awareness. So we've only been here, right, for about 3 years, I'll call it actual heavy in advertising. So clearly at the top of the funnel, we need to drive a lot more visits and keep it up there so I know what my conversion ratios are. We find that we get a lot more of our lower funnel activity off of those visits when I can use more of the addressable to start driving them down through the funnel. Also, which is a part that you can't really measure, when you've got a dealer group that's investing the millions of dollars they are into the store, there is just an emotional good feeling of people in general, whether they're in market or not. Just you're on watching March Madness and you see an Alpha commercial on, it's kind of like, oh man, these guys are together, they're buying March Madness, they clearly got it going on. Dealers get excited, customers get excited. Even if they're not buying, when you buy a premium car, you want somebody else to be like, oh yeah, it's an Alpha? Oh, I get you, I see it. Yeah, I saw that thing on TV. There's this reinforcement factor of working through that, where I think those two together We've easily, that's been the most efficient way to drive the metrics through our funnel, from an overall visits down to our lower funnel activity and then converting into an application. Those are really our three biggest metrics that we use, so we tie them back to that strategy.
Over here. Oh, we have one over here?
Yeah, right here. Steve. Okay. Steve.
Whoop. I
can't see anything.
There's one mic, so I'm right.
Okay.
Oh.
Let's do this one, and then we'll go across here. We have time.
Hi, I'm Tammy Greenberg. I'm with the Radio Advertising Bureau. I was actually at the ANA, the Association of National Advertiser Media Conference, last week, and there was a lot of conversation around how hot audio is right now, and most specifically as the world is becoming more and more adept at voice and using artificial intelligence speakers and stuff to ask for what they want. So I'm wondering if you all have an audio strategy and if you've put thought behind developing a sonic brand and if there's anything that you, if you could just elaborate on that.
No, I don't think, it's not really something that we've gone to in that realm. Obviously, look, launching the brand and the amount of resources that we can put at it, I think it's, there's a lot of flowers to water. And there's a lot of things that we need to work through. So I will call it maybe some of the more core fundamental strategies is really kind of in our playbook right now. That one I know it gives a return. It's super interesting, by the way, what you bring up. We certainly try to find different unique cutting edge tactics and different things that we can do from that standpoint, but not something that we've gravitated to. I think there's a lot of opportunity that we've just to fill the different buckets. We talked about broadcast and social media, and we've got a bit of a playbook going in that space. That's not something that we've rounded out with, but I'm actually intrigued as well to see what you bring up and where you go, what other opportunities are, and what the proper playbook is to actually execute it and get the efficiency. So I'm probably a little bit more paranoid in that space of, look, once I got something working, unless it's broke, I'm not going to fix it. So we keep marching through this, and we continue to see our volume grow. And I like the data return. So there's also, we talked about data. Having consistent data on what we're building is super imperative because it helps me develop the strategy on the question we just had previously. So having consistency in what we're building, continuously tweaking and adjusting every week with our partners, it goes a long way. But your question is super interesting where I think the market can develop.
Over here.
I was just wondering how Alfa Romeo leverages its racing heritage, motorsport racing heritage, for the consumer brand.
Yeah, so when it comes to racing, I think first, there's just a legitimacy where if you build an affiliation to a racing brand like F1, whether you're an F1 fan in the United States or you're not, I think everybody universally agrees it's the most difficult racing circuit in the world. So to be a part of something like that, it also legitimizes not only that you're here, but two, that you're not kidding around. And if you say that you're gonna build performance cars, your cars need to deliver not only on the track from F1, but you're also gonna see some pretty incredible vehicles at our dealerships with Quadrifoglios and even our base powertrains. So, and then from us, just the legitimate learnings that come from being on a racing team like F1 that we can apply real world applications to our cars. I mean, if you didn't stop and explain to somebody that we've got a carbon fiber drive shaft that's directly driven from an F1 experience, or that the adjustable pedals on the side are set up a particular way off of the column to be driven off of F1, which is directly where it's inspired from to deliver that driving experience. All of those little nuances help articulate an incredible story and deliver a very unique product that not necessarily our competitors approach that way. So I don't think there could have been a better move. And me personally, which I don't know every single thing about F1, but the reception already in the US and what historically isn't necessarily as followed as maybe in Europe has been overwhelming. That's one of the things that absolutely surprised me.
We have time for one more.
Hi, Greg Hughes from Intercom Communications. You talked about email and TV and digital. Does radio play a part in your marketing objectives across the U.S.?
Yeah, we're talking through radio. We have part of that. There's part of the tier two and definitely picking particular markets to drive home the message. Anything on an awareness building, Brad, then I can drive home and constantly hearing the term Alfa Romeo. I mean, there's some people, I mean, we kind of joke where they'll say an Alfa Romero, or like they're still learning. They don't know. You know, where I really like to see the brand go, and there's the voiceover with radio in particular, there's a cachet that goes with the brand. And if we can get to the point where you sit next to the guy next to you and go, hey, what do you drive? I drive an Alfa. When that term alone has a cachet and a value to it, that's when we know we're headed in the right path. So I like radio in that element to continue to sort of drive home the message. I've heard the term Alfa Romeo. I know how to say it. I know how to drive home that thing. I think we can get our message across and definitely sort of get people excited. Oh, yeah, I heard about that. Oh, yeah, I've seen one. Now I've seen it on social, and it continuously reinforces where I'm trying to get you to stop into my dealership and see what's going on. Maybe this is a car for me. So, yeah, no, like radio as well.
Bob, we'll have you back soon to check if that's the case. All right. Bob, thank you very much.
Guys, I appreciate your time. Thank you.
It used to be really simple, selling cars, power, speed, romance of the road. It has become a lot more complicated as the product has become more complicated. And communicating that has become more intricate. And to talk about that part of the marketing mix now and that part of evolution and how you communicate not only more complicated understanding of what a car is,
yeah, this is live.
Hello? There we go. Hi, everyone. So I'm excited to be here today with... Amber and Ian. And I'd like at first to just tell everyone a little bit about ourselves. So Ian, do you want to start? Oh, I'll wait till you're done.
You start.
I'll start. I own the S3 agency. We're a full-service creative agency, and automotive is one of our specialties. So it's great to be here today.
I'm Ian Beavis. I'm with AMCI Global. We work with pretty much every OEM. We specialize in the auto industry. We do vehicle testing, we do training, and we do experiential. We basically do everything in the marketing sphere except advertising.
Hi there. Ooh, this one definitely works. My name is Amber Quist. I am the CMO of Silvercar. Just by quick show of hands, anybody familiar with Silvercar here? Okay, good. So Silvercar, we have actually three distinct business units that we operate now. We were fully acquired by Audi in 2017. We started with a simple idea to disrupt the nascent car rental industry and to simplify it using technology. And we've kind of spun from there and also operate a product called Dealerware that we sell into dealerships. And just last year, we also launched the Audi Select subscription model as part of our first Audi-branded product that's in the market now. So thank you for having me.
Great. So we're here to talk a little bit about automotive and product innovation and consumer education, whether or not we can get people to adopt the things that we're putting out there. When Ian and I first spoke, I said, oh, I know your company because years ago we did your branding and we did your logo, which is a manual transmission six-speed. And his response to me...
Yeah, well, a six-speed manual transmission is referred to as a millennial anti-theft device these days. I actually drive a six-speed car, and at least once a month at valet parking, the valet looks at me and goes, not happening, you better drive it there.
So, you know, the whole idea of how we embrace driving your cars and their purpose in our lives is changing. It's changing with newer generations. It's changing with life use cases. Obviously, what you're doing is a very significant change. And how are you communicating that? How are you getting something complex like Silvercar that you feel you have to explain to a room full of people who are in the industry? How do we get consumers to adopt that and dealers?
So it's a big question. I'll start first with maybe our recent product, which is Audi Select. So I think that we all, as consumers, know that our consumer behaviors are changing and we have different expectations of brands today than we've ever had before. And, you know, we want things on demand. We want to pay for only what we use. And so Silvercar recognized that with Audi, and we aren't certainly not the first to market in the subscription space. So we have, in some cases, I think that when you're introducing new technology, there's can be advantages to that. There's some education that already existed out there in applying the subscription model to the world of transportation. And so in terms of adoption, there's a couple things that I think we are looking at, and it's really about, you know, involving the dealerships first. And so we've made a big effort to have them be partners in this. We're live in Dallas only, so we're in a single market. And we have relied heavily on that relationship to help sell into the consumer base there as well. So, you know, we do a lot of traditional forms of advertising at point of launch, but we also look at it in terms of an ecosystem. So in terms of adoption, a lot of early customers are people that also have experienced Silver Car as well. So there was a little bit of cross-marketing effort that happened there as also.
Is there an opportunity, I mean, subscription in terms of having partial use of a car or, you know, different cars instead of one car? Can we do that with technology? Is there a way to give people just the technology they want to subscribe to in a car versus the whole gamut and having them pay for everything they don't want?
It's limited probably to the entertainment area, but, you know, because most of the, you know, you've got several layers of technology in a car, and so the only real subscription piece to it at the moment that I know of is in the entertainment area. The cars have got loaded up with technology. An interesting statistic is that if you've got a five-year-old car and you're trading it in at the moment, the new car that you're getting has anywhere between 40 and 60% more technology than the car you're trading in. And about half of that is sort of hidden. It's stuff that you need to know about, but you don't even know it's there unless someone tells you. It's a bit of a problem for the industry, frankly.
Oh, it's definitely. I've worked with BMW for over the past 20 years, and I drive a BMW, and I don't use half the tech features in there. So, you know, when you take delivery of your car, no one wants to sit down and go through all the tech. So how do we get people to be more aware of and care about it?
Well, there's a couple of things. One thing that the problem that the industry is now having, of course, is affordability. You know, people are getting pushed. You know, the reason the subscription services and so on is there is an affordability element to this, not wanting to pay for more than you need and not being able to pay more. But this affordability issue is being driven a lot by product, by all this technology that's coming into the cars. Either it's being legislated or it's seen to be a good idea, a lot of it being safety systems, none of which are cheap. And while people today, you know, 95% of their activity is online, you know, to search through the vehicle, there is very little online that truly helps you understand the value of the safety systems. And, you know, frankly, it's a real issue because if you really need to physically experience the product or some better demonstration of it, like AR or VR, because to physically do it, to experience the safety system would put someone in peril. So our business, it's a really big deal. But if you as a consumer have gone online, you've seen the price of the car and you're going to go into the dealer and you're going to cut the deal, if you don't know the true value of what is in that car, the dealer is at an enormous disadvantage and you get into this whole, how much money am I going to get off and off I go. So this is an imperative for the industry to somehow change this situation, to get people to physically experience the product and give that opportunity, that human interaction, that moment of magic to help explain and help them understand and be frankly excited about the opportunity that all of these features and technologies have. It's a real challenge, before sale and after.
Well, yeah, for sure. Okay.
I just wanted to jump in there. So you talking about sort of experiential, I think as we look at involvement in the dealerships, we really have started to see a shift, I think, in dealerships becoming more product experts. Yeah. We know that consumers do most of their research online today, so they're 80% informed before they ever even enter a dealership. And so really it sort of changes the profile on who you hire. Today, the salesperson looks a little bit different than they may have looked in the past.
Absolutely.
And I think then furthermore, you asked, how do we get customers to care? And I would sort of back up and say, are we actually developing tech for tech's sake, or are we developing technology that actually solves a real problem? Customers care when you solve a need that exists, not necessarily create a problem that isn't there. And so I think that's important in sort of on the manufacturer side, that we are thinking about what are the most important problems that we actually need to solve, and we're not just creating technology for technology's sake.
Yeah, well, to that point, an interesting one is lane departure warning. We've done some research on this, and one of the fascinating things is if the person is not shown at the delivery what lane departure warning is actually doing and how they have to operate it, they will turn it off.
Yeah.
Yet it's probably one of the best features in a modern car. Very early on, backup cameras, which became mandatory. But people would say, I don't need to pay for $250 for a backup camera. I can look over my shoulder. Until they actually experience one, and they'll never go back. So, and it's very difficult, no matter how good you are online, to actually give the person that true experience. You really do have to do it firsthand.
You know, when you were talking about how the technology changes from 5 years ago to now, I mean,
I don't know anybody that has a phone from 5 years ago. So, you know, it's monumental. It's very difficult for manufacturers to figure out what isn't going to be easily replaced, right? Why would you ever pay for a GPS system now, right? Like, but it is built into cars that people are still paying for. How do we kind of try to game the system and see the things that will be very special that only we can offer as automotive?
Oh, that's a huge challenge. I think we're going to see more. There's going to be more of a discussion about this with autonomy, which Audi's, you know, very, very up in the lead on autonomy. But so much of the technology behind autonomy is going to always be unbranded, and it's going to be somewhat undifferentiated. There's going to be a base level of activity on autonomy, and then you're going to have this overlay for each of the brands. So there is an opportunity to brand some of these technologies, but I think it's only a little bit. You know, everyone's going to tune their vehicle slightly differently. They're going to, you know, do certain things, but the basic safety levels are going to be very, very similar. And the expense is going to have to be spread over a multitude of auto companies. I think, you know, when you've got a company as large as the VW Group, you know, the largest, wanting to team up with other people tells you the money involved in here before you're ever going to see any return is enormous. And so much of it's undifferentiated.
Yeah, it's a really interesting time, I think, right? Because as someone who loves to drive, there's never been a better opportunity to buy any car. Pretty much is amazing these days. It's just, what do you like best? Mm-hmm. But we're seeing, you know, some generational changes of how people view cars and what their role is in our society. Mm-hmm. What are the innovative things? And it doesn't have to be technology that can really help people have that joy. Is that what people will prize and what they will pay more for? What are some things like that you can think of or that you think should be happening?
You know, I think from the Audi perspective, we're really looking at, we know that the landscape is changing, right? All OEMs have this challenge in front of them to look at new mobility solutions. And so we're really focused on, no matter where you are, you have access to an Audi, whether you're traveling, whether you are, you know, in an urban area, whether you, you know, no matter where you are, you have access. So, and I think the other point of access is also having the opportunity to have fractional ownership and flexibility within that model. So as we look at sort of building that ecosystem, you know, things like subscription, that might in the future be something that's offered at the F&I desk. You know, you might go in and purchase an e-tron and want to have the experience with an electric vehicle, but you know, in order to sort of get over the hump and instill electric confidence, you might also have the need to drive much further than maybe the infrastructure supports today. And so you know, instead of taking your e-tron on that long vacation, you might have a subscription-based model through the F&I desk that allows you to have a combustion experience that allows you to travel those miles.
That's a great point, right? People are so afraid of electric vehicles not supporting their needs, and the average miles that we drive every day is 30, right?
Yeah.
So that is a great, I think, way to get the emotion past it.
Yeah.
Because you've got like a security blanket.
Right.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. And I think you had mentioned to me when we were speaking earlier the idea of helping dealers to bridge gaps, you know, from lease to lease, or, you know, rather than people going to another mark, by having Select available to let people have a couple months of pretty much almost any Audi they want to drive.
Yeah, I think that's been what's interesting about the Select is that, you know, we certainly launched it with the idea that subscription-based model related to transportation allows people flexibility to change models. And what we're learning is that, you know, some people are certainly flipping cars on a regular basis, but other people are using it to bridge between leases. Other people are using it to test drive a specific vehicle before purchase. So it has, you know, we launched Select in 6 months. It was concept to launch in 6 months, which is pretty impressive feat for an OEM, which was part of the reason that the acquisition happened for Silver Car to be able to move nimbly. But the, you know, we launched with a minimum viable product, and we're learning and kind of iterating based on the insights that we're gaining.
You know, cars, if you take education out, cars are the second most expensive purchases we generally make. Or really nice jewelry. And, you know, people are supposed to be really excited about it. They're supposed to be doing something that makes them feel great about it. And when we drive off the lot, we always hear, oh, you've lost, you know, fill in the blank number of thousands of dollars. Mm-hmm. But now with things like Tesla, where they, you know, basically download all new things to your car, suddenly you have a car that's worth more
or at least seems like a better car than when you bought it. What does that mean?
Oh, connectivity. 5G, you know, is a game changer in the industry. You know, Tesla's got to jump on everyone with their downloading, and it's really. I've got several friends with Teslas, and you know, they're absolutely enamored with the technology. I have no idea what they have no idea about the car, but that's beside the point. But 5G is going to be a tremendous opportunity for the industry, and it's a tremendous way also for the OEMs for the first time to have some sort of direct connection with their customers. And it's not to, you know, eliminate the dealer from the process, but today, you know, other than a recall, a manufacturer very rarely has a direct connection to a customer. With 5G connectivity in the car, they will be able to have a positive connection to the customer and enhance their enjoyment. And frankly, to the point that was made earlier, some degree of tailoring of the car. It's going to help the brands a lot. It's going to help loyalty. I think silver car is brilliant in terms of enhancing the loyalty for Audi. I'm just surprised that, you know, more haven't got onto that boat, but I don't wish it to. No, connectivity and the ability to download and upgrade. Also, for recalls, so much of what's going on in the car now is electronic, and as it gets more to EVs, it's going to even be more so. So recalls or anything that's going to happen to the car is going to be electronically done. You don't have to take it into the dealership. Just imagine, you know, having to wait for parts and whatever else. You can just download it, change the software, it's done overnight and you don't even have to worry about it. It's going to be wonderful for customer experience.
Yeah, I mean, I think Tesla is a great example of, I think one of your questions earlier was, you know, what do OEMs do in the future to continue to stay relevant in terms of customer adoption of technology? And I think Tesla is a prime example of they operate as a software company, essentially. And so the more and more mindset that we can have related to how do we release products faster from an MVP, most viable product state, and test and learn, then the more insights we gain, the better products we create that do address needs of our customers, and the more product adoption that we have moving forward.
Yeah, Tesla started out as a software company. It was the metal bending that got them, you know, sort of messed up.
Yeah. So the elephant in the room, right? Autonomous vehicles. Mm-hmm. What are your feelings on that? When is that really going to happen?
Well, it's happening. But here's the thing. You're going to see level 4 autonomy within the next couple of years in geo-fenced areas and at low speeds, those sorts of things. But, you know, the day of you getting into your Audi and, you know, hopping into the driveway and, you know, pressing the button and it takes you to work is quite some time away. Not from necessarily a technological standpoint, but a legal standpoint, there's a myriad of steps to be made there. You know, certainly the low speed activities with autonomy, they're very close. And frankly, lane departure, automatic collision avoidance, those sorts of things, they are forms of autonomy. So we do have levels. The problem we've got is that we have someone who'll remain nameless, starting with T, had a thing called autopilot, and everyone thinks, my God, we've got full autonomy out there, and we haven't. And you say you have the impression of full autonomy with really stupid people behind the wheel doing stupid things that puts everyone backwards.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a whole lot to add in terms of that. I mean, I will say that levels of autonomy, we are getting used to this already today. I was in a vehicle the other day, took my hands off the wheel, parallel parked itself, kind of scared me. But, you know, even just sitting in traffic the other day and sitting still, motorcycle passes, and all of a sudden the, you know, seatbelt tightens on you. There are lots of things that exist today that are, you know, without maybe even us realizing it, we're getting used to autonomous features. But everything you say, I mean, nobody really knows how close we will be to sitting in autonomous vehicles. I hope that my children, who are 4 and 6, won't be behind the wheel themselves. I do hope that there are, you know, more autonomy when they actually start driving, but I think we don't know. I do think the technology, to your point, will be here faster than some of the regulatory and infrastructure things that have to take place for us.
It's very unusual for a regulator to decide to not get involved. That tells you they have no clue what's going on, because they'd love to get their hands in this stuff.
Yeah. Well, one place that, you know, they're definitely involved in is the whole dealer model and how we're buying cars, right? Consumers really want to go direct for everything, right? Even for, you know, Invisaligns, instead of going through an orthodontist, now they can just go to Smile Direct and be their own orthodontist, basically. Yeah. When do we think that will happen? Will that happen? How will the role of the dealer
change?
Well,
I think that the challenge is consumers will, you know, it's like water going down a hill. Consumers will go where they need to go to get what they need in the way they need it. A dealer can be in that process if he's adding value and not disrupting or causing a problem. And so we work with a lot of dealer groups, and you know what goes on, you know, your time when you're buying a car, what you're on when you're online or when you're in the dealership looking at the car, that's your time, and you spend as much time doing that as you want. What you don't want is it from the moment you say yes to be screwed around for 45 minutes to 2.5 hours on all paperwork and bullshit. So in order for the dealers and anyone to remain relevant, they have to somehow compress that, make it as pain-free as possible, and add value to the process, teaching the person about the car or something. And then when the delivery comes on, when you're picking up the car, you have the choice of how much time you want to spend on that, so don't make that hard. So it's taking friction out of the system. And I don't know that there's, you know, and I'm not defending the current status quo, because I will tell you that, you know, Tesla's got some real problems with their model too, because, you know, the Model 3 has put such stress on their system that they've got some serious issues going on there. So there isn't one answer that fits all. But I think you've got to, if you want to be relevant, you have to reduce friction for the consumer. And how you do that is, you know, you don't need a franchise system or not have a franchise. It doesn't. That's not the issue. It's how you reduce friction.
Yeah, I mean, I think we definitely see the future for dealerships being very relevant and important to the whole mobility ecosystem. So there's a view that we have that is really seeing dealerships as mobility hubs, and as time goes on, being able to operate more mobility as service options out of the dealership, which is why subscription in Dallas today, we work very closely with our dealerships there. And more of the operational things that we operate today as Silver Car are shifting to you know, a shared operational model between the dealers and Silver Car. So certainly see as time moves on, and you know, the reality too, even with autonomous vehicles, people will still buy cars. We know that there's, you know, a slowdown in that, but we still believe that there will be an ownership model in the future too.
What about privacy issues, right? We're afraid of privacy from Alexa and from every smart thing that we have. What about us cars?
And they are listening. it is an issue, and that's an issue that the industry is confronting. And the other part of the problem that the industry has is they've got, you know, model cycles that are very long, and there's hardened systems inside the car that have, you know, different protocols. So a car is a very complicated vehicle, and adding voice and all of these other things to it from industries that are very fast moving, because, you know, these things get replaced much more often than a car. The average car on the road in the United States is 11.4 years old. That's the average. You know, that's an antique. You know, that's seven phones.
Yeah, no one's got their phone.
So there are challenges to it. But voice is very important, and it is interesting. Voice has been a huge challenge for cars. It's one thing to stand here and scream into Alexa. It's another thing to be going at 60 miles down the road in a nice sports car that's got a lot of ambient noise and trying to make, and with an Australian accent, and trying to make the bloody thing understand you. It's impossible.
I'd love to have anyone who has questions have access to our very esteemed panel guests here, so please go ahead and let anyone know. No? In the meantime, we have one?
No, there's one there and there.
Check out. It is hard to see. It's blinding.
Hi, I'm Sulin Valine with Nexstar Media Group, and I was thinking about the Audi experience, and how are you executing, or what are you actually seeing as far as marketing? Who is this appealing to? Is there a type of, you know, persona that you're seeing is gravitating towards that?
Yeah, I mean, we, from a demographic standpoint, definitely see more males than females today in the select experience. On the Silver Car side, on the rental side, that's more balanced. There was a perception early on when I first came to the company 2 years ago that we were more like 80% male, 20% female, but the reality that we actually just did a recent customer study that females are just as active as males are in the research and purchase phase of renting a car, which is why we announced a Peg Perigo partnership last year to outfit all of our vehicles with car seats to start to broaden the appeal to the family and female traveler. But on the Select side, on the subscription side, definitely more dominated on the male. And then, as you would imagine, the entry point is $14.95 a month, so that's going to obviously, self-select. Yeah, going to yeah, self-select, exactly. But we did just announce on Tuesday that we have a new tier to that, so we have a $9.95 offer that's going to be sort of a more limited selection in models. So we're testing sort of pricing and product packaging as well.
And Amber, am I wrong? Does that include insurance?
That does include insurance, amazing. Two flips a month, and concierge delivery, and also Silver Car days. So when you part of this too, I mean, we were talking earlier just about. The value equation has really changed for customers today, right? So people value convenience, they value their time, and they value simplicity. That is a little bit of a challenge to educate people because they're used to, from what they're used to. So from a lease, you know, my lease only costs today $6.95, but when you start to add up all the different features, the value that you get out of the subscription-based model actually starts to make more sense for certain scenarios.
Well, it makes sense in so many other things, right?
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Pat Hill. I'm with Jackson Spaulding. I have a question for all three panelists, and it goes back to something Ian said about product cycle and the time it takes to develop a new vehicle. Why have none of the manufacturers gone after Tesla in a bigger, faster way? Tesla has been doing this now for several years, has been very successful, yet none of the major OEMs or even minor OEMs have been able to even try to replicate it. Why is that?
There's a couple of reasons for it. First of all, the other OEMs have to make money for a living. And it's as successful as Tesla has been. It's, you know, it has basically been a cash incinerator, except for a few quarters. I think there's a couple of things. One is, and you know, let's face it, the electric cars we've got coming, they wouldn't be happening like they are if it wasn't for Tesla. And so from Elon's standpoint, he succeeded. That said, I think there was some reticence about, you know, really is the world ready for electric cars? He started at the top end with people who are interested in technology paying $100,000 for cars. So that's a very rarefied market. And frankly, the people that were in that market, they're doing just fine, thank you very much. So it's taken a while to take hold. I think that sort of the wake-up moment for some people in the industry was when Tesla was the biggest selling luxury car in California at one point and like, oops. Now, I would also say that depends on how you define luxury, because I would say to you with respect that it's a $100,000 car with a Honda Accord interior. It's not a luxury car as I would define one if you compare it to an I-Pace Jaguar. So I think there was reticence, there's a lot of investment, and there's shareholders and there's always lots of research. And you know, I don't think Elon did a lot of research. I was thinking, hell, I'm going to go and do it. So there's lots of inertia. Every industry needs a disruptor. I think he's done a perfectly good job. I think you've got Rivian out there disrupting in the pickup truck area. But you've now got this relentless machine of all these other manufacturers coming down this path with significant investments in infrastructure, because that really is a big part of the problem. And you know, moving the price down will require government subsidies. So I think he's got a head start, but it's hard to stay out in front. It's going to be very hard. Again, just look at, you know, these very, very large car companies having to join forces to develop this technology. You know, I don't believe there is an OEM on the planet that would find that what Tesla has as autopilot is acceptable for a consumer. You don't use your consumers as guinea pigs. And I just don't think, you know, and by the way, no one's going to sue Tesla, but they'll sue the Volkswagen Group back to the Stone Age. So there's a lot more risk. I don't have an opinion on that at all.
No, not at all. You know, Prius was doing a pretty good job before Tesla came along, and it took a while for that to happen. And so now we're seeing Rivian, we're seeing others, all the major OEMs are going after it. I think, to your point, they have to uphold their level of branding and, you know, dealer commitment and everything. With that, it's easy. I don't say it's easy, but you can certainly start from scratch and take on legislators and just go out and sell direct and do all these things that OEMs can't really do right now. So I think that was probably part of it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a ton to add. I think they hit all the key points. Profitability, accountability.
We have a saying in Australia that today you're an ostrich and tomorrow you're a feather duster. And, you know, Tesla Model X and Model S sales are collapsing. He hasn't got a next generation of either of those coming. Model 3 is starting to sell outside the United States and in Europe and so on, which is great. He keeps teasing Model Y. When? You know, he's got some major issues coming around, and you know, this is a very capital incentive business, and he's got some real stress and strains there. So we'll see where it goes.
I'm Jim Ehrlich with GFK Auto. Had a question based on a lot of what you said. Amber, you had mentioned, you know, your 4 and 6 year olds, you know, might not ever drive or might not need to. If we think about, you know, I'm not a doomsday sayer that, you know, car industry is going to go away. People need to move shit. We all agree. Ian, you had mentioned, you know, car ownership these days, cars are over 10 years old. So at what point do we actually see autonomous function commoditizing auto ownership, where the appeal or the need that's driven into getting the next car, does it put us out of work? Do we start moving towards an airline model where, you know, who cares what car you're in as long as the service is there?
Oh, God, I hope I'm dead. no, I think there is, you know, there's always been a body of the population that aren't that interested in cars and get them as an appliance. So that's going to exist, and it'll grow in even flow. I think in terms of autonomy, you're going to see autonomy turn up in places that we don't talk about much. Trucks, delivery vans, in small geofenced areas, those sorts of areas. Much faster than I think, you know, you're going to see it in passenger cars and general usage vehicles. I think there's still a lot of opportunity for branding there. There was a great comment made the other day. You know, everyone tries to talk about the death of the car because you don't use it 96% of the time. You know, why would you have one? Well, I use a toothbrush twice a day. Why the bloody hell would I give it to someone else to use when I'm not using it? I still want my toothbrush, so there'll still be that going on. So I do think that there's still going to be some desire for car ownership. I think what's going to happen, though, is when you've got a household with, say, 3 cars or 2 cars, they might go back to 1. You'll see those different models, and they will vary by geographic area and they'll vary by life stage. You know, when you start to have a family, you seem to gather more crap than creation, and you need that hauler. You don't necessarily want a subscription service and be swapping all that crap out of the car to your baby seat thing. So there's lots of permutations of this. I think if you're in the research business, you've got a target-rich environment out there to find out what the hell's going on.
Yeah, I think that brand has probably never been more important. When the gentleman from Mazda was talking about how they want to be their fans' number one brand, not number one automotive brand, but number one brand, that's a high aspiration. But I think it is something, especially if we're going to go back to single-car households, that we want to be the one they choose, and it's going to be more than just because we're a car.
Denise and panel, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
We want to welcome our next sponsor to talk about location-based marketing in the age of data. Now, I can't, as a journalist, as an impartial journalist, I can't endorse the company, but I can endorse those socks that they've distributed around. The Sock Club socks really are comfortable, so take them home and try them. But I want to welcome the Chief Commercial Officer of Outfront Media, Andy Srubis, to talk about location-based marketing. Andy.
Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody. I have about 10 minutes to talk a little bit about location-based marketing, which is essentially the out-of-home business. So 5 years ago when I joined Outfront Media, which was the former CBS Outdoor, I didn't know much about out-of-home media. I was hired to do a job to change the technology associated with out-of-home media, and now it's all I look at. So I drive by a billboard, I'm constantly looking at who owns that billboard, what's the ad copy on it, what are the metrics associated with that particular location. It's a phenomenal different science now that we've created around out-of-home media so that we can equate it to Google and Facebook and all the other digital mediums that are out there. And so what I'd like to take you through today in just about 10 minutes is how our world has evolved so substantially over the last 5 years to be included in the big pitch when we're talking about how you get your message out, how you get attribution back, and what the kind of the metrics we can use so that you can equate this type of media to everything else that you're buying across the spectrum. So as I push through this stuff, the world has changed and continues to change. We talk about exponential growth in the use of technology associated specifically with media. But if you think about cord cutting, ad blocks, distrust around the way that you get metrics back from the big guys, Google, Facebook, and others, and distraction, people are doing many other things. Intrusive media is a bit of a pain in the rear end now. It's not necessarily something that you're going to look forward to when you get to your phone. What we're hoping to do with location-based media, in transit, on billboards, and all the rest, is to be something that earns the attention of the audiences that receive it. And so whether you're in the subway system here in New York, where we're putting 50,000 digital screens, or you're driving down the West Side Highway, there are signs everywhere where the creative is designed to engage you for some period of time. Not too long, so that you're distracted by when you're driving, but something that gives you the opportunity to engage with an ad and to learn something out of that opportunity, rather than something that is more intrusive, as we talk about Facebook and Google and others doing that. As we switch, look at the trends here. These are real numbers. So television down 2% this year, but I think that's actually going to, or last year, that's going to accelerate as OTT and other things come into play and we start getting real metrics around what television is doing. Appointment television is over. There's no need to do it. Now you can do it whenever you want to do it. Radio down, magazines down big time, newspapers down. And this follows several years of the same trends. And so the effectiveness of those ads has come down, but the number of dollars spent in each of those places doesn't necessarily yet reflect the trend that's occurring here. And so you're not really getting the audiences that you're paying for. The interesting thing about home to this point in time has been that it's been very difficult to disrupt, which is great for us. We're not going through the things that the web disrupted print, that Apple TV, Spotify, Pandora disrupted radio, and TVs being disrupted by the OTT services and all the other video services that are out there. Out of home doesn't have that issue. So there was never really this drive to change the technology so quickly around this. But what we had discovered a few years ago was that the opportunity was there to start to evaluate value in out-of-home. What are you buying? What are you investing in as a CMO or a CFO of a company that wants to advertise relative to the other mediums that are there? And so we started to think about how the platforms can be done in such a way. And I'm going to take you through a little bit of that. So out-of-home has been up. In these last couple of years, in fact, in the last about 48 quarters, if I get it correct, we've been up about 3% every time. And that's essentially because we're not participating in this disruption that's there, but we want to participate in the wave of the uptake so we can apply digital metrics to the advertising folks that we, or the advertising mediums that we use. And we're everywhere. You can't block this. This is something that's unblockable. If you start thinking about the ads that are there, you look forward to them. And going through Times Square, maybe it's a little sensory overload, but you're going to be involved in that experience. When you go down into the subway system now, if you take any one of the 456 line, the ACE line here in New York, we've put digital screens, 65-inch gorgeous screens on the wall, and we're going to invest almost $1 billion into the system here in New York to get that audience, 6 million passengers a day here. We're doing the same thing in Boston and DC and Atlanta and San Francisco and others, because the audiences here are diverse. They have dwell time. They are paying attention to what it is. You can interact on your phone while you're looking at an ad. These things are not the obnoxiousness that digital media has come to be. And so as we started thinking about where we're going with this, we started to say, hey, wait a minute, what is our reach relative to other things? We never thought about this in the out-of-home world. How do we compare relative to Facebook and Google and others and television? In New York, more people see an ad that Outfront Media put on our outside berms than ABC, NBC, and CBS combined. That's a pretty big audience. Oh, and it's diverse. And we can start targeting. So you start thinking about if that can do that, then the value of our media should be much bigger than probably what it is. So we have to be able to tell that story. 70% of your time is spent outside, 68% of your mobile time is spent while you're outside. So you're interacting with signs in locations, and location is what I think a little bit could be the missing link in the out-of-home world. You got reach, you got frequency, but location also brings you a psychographic information. So you happen to be driving by a Home Depot, you're in a better mode to turn off and buy fertilizer than when you're sitting back on the couch watching a television ad. There's things that you can then present to people at a particular point in time where they're in tune to be able to accept that message or that signal that you're trying to send to them and reinforce it in other ways. We combine mobile significantly with out-of-home so that your one-to-one reaction is on the mobile phone, but you're getting the big message on the billboard, or you're getting the big message on the screens that you're walking past. And so how do we start to monetize this stuff? So if location is that important, and we understand it can't be obscured in any way, and we know that you're going to receive the message, then how do we try to get the efficacy of our media relative to others? So we start thinking about a new way. We start analyzing the data that's associated with these things. So we now can understand in a very privacy-protected way, so I don't want to be in any way thinking about we're stealing PII from anyone, we can understand movements of real people in real time. So with cellular data and all the rest that's working around, we can now take audiences and figure out what their journey patterns are throughout the day, what locations that we're advertising can be placed they pass, what locations that they travel on with regard to by a store, by a location, by all the different things that they need to do so that we can understand the audiences, where they live, where they work, and what they do throughout the day, and then combine that with some demographic information on an aggregated and anonymous basis, and now we all of a sudden have a network of ad screens that starts to bring along the same type of information that you get from your digital one-to-one marketing. So audience data, massive amount of sets of data, massive amount of sets of data are collected every day through your cell phone and the rest, and so we can start to collect that data as well and assess it. How many people are familiar with Axiom Personics and all the things, right? So if you're buying media, you know it. Wouldn't it be great to understand your audience is driving past a billboard in the same 1,400 different categories? We can now do that. So we can understand by kids starting out, or you want to buy the millennial Hispanic female audience that happens to be SUV intenders. We can start doing the same type of demographic breakdown and behavioral breakdowns that you can do on Facebook and Google, like you log into Facebook Ad Manager or double click and start to understand which boards index which against which demographic categories the same way. Now you can start to compare value. How many impressions can I get here in the same category that I'm getting over here? And I don't have any of the other bad problems associated with that. And we collect all of those signals. We start to think about that from a standpoint of attribution as well. So can then I track somebody who said, all right, this group of people were exposed to this ad at this particular place. I know from historical data that they haven't actually gone to a Starbucks or they haven't actually gone into that dealership. Well, if they haven't gone there, but now they're starting to, there's some positive evidence that the out-of-home campaign, as long as I can isolate the signal from out-of-home, is having an effect, a positive effect on this. We're getting lift out of it. We're getting more traffic. We're getting foot traffic. We're getting phone calls. We're getting web insights. We can start to think about this in any other way, in the same ways as every other media. And that's really important for us to be able to bring the value of our media up and for you to start to sell that stuff. And so when we start to then plan this, you can log on, like I said before, on Facebook Ad Manager, and say, I'm looking for these millennial Hispanic females in New York, and all of the applications for our boards will be available to you, and you can say, here's the ones that index best against this audience. And like a little bit like a Amazon basket, you can pull ones out, put them in, and it'll adjust the audience so you understand what you're doing. Here's how much I want to spend. Here's how much I want in September. Is it available? Is it not? And play along with an interface that is very user-friendly for you, just like any other media. And I joined the company 5 years ago. It was kind of shocking to me that we still didn't have this types of data sets available in a digital way. But as we've started to build it, we all of a sudden are kind of participate in the modern world of advertising. In fact, even surpass some of the big mistakes that folks have made in these places. So as we start to do some of these things, we think about all the different crowds that we can possibly have, the affluent households, the rest of the stuff. And so as an auto industry, you all know very well the kind of customers you want. You want to reinforce loyalty. You want to bring new customers in. You want to change the new products that you've got launched. All of that is now available in the out-of-home space. And so our team starts spending lots of time as sort of media advocates and media advisors as opposed to billboard salespeople. And that's kind of the big change for the way that our industry is working. And when we start to do that stuff, you start to understand the power of that relative to other media, and it lifts all boats. Ultimately, be a little self-serving here, what we want to do is to pull budgets from other media. So try to convince you that because we're so much less expensive than some of those other medias, and so much more valuable in terms of what we're delivering to you, that you can switch budgets around to be able to do some of that stuff. And that's what we're trying to convince folks, because we can now do it with that data. Look outside right here as you walk out of the Javits Center. This particular board right there, that's an out front board with a Genesis on it, we can pull up all of these metrics. That's the kind of information you want to be able to have, and then you can play with it based on the board, the location, the time of day, and the information there. If it's a digital sign, it has just as much dynamic content capability as any other sign or your cell phone. And that's the way we do our things. Did I make it in 10 minutes?
Oh, yeah.
I made it in 10 minutes. Any questions while I have 12 seconds left? Well, that was easy then. All right, thanks very much, appreciate it.
Thank you, Andy.
Thanks. We're gonna take our coffee break now, which Andy and the group at Outfront has sponsored. So go out and have your afternoon coffee break. In about 15 minutes, we're going to hand over to our partner, Ed Club of New York, that is going to be talking about and having a special session on understanding the new driver and understanding the consumer. We're also remember that we have cocktail, courtesy of Legends, and a show floor visit at 5. So grab some coffee. We'll start back up in about 15, 20 minutes.
Heart is a blue, shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck, and the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck, and you're not moving anywhere. You thought you take you out of this place. Someone you can lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful. Praying hard, said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars. Yeah, we'll be counting stars. I see this life like a swinging vine, swing my heart across the line. My face is
flashing signs. Seek it out and ye shall find. Old, but I'm not that old. Young, but I'm not that bold.